Our liberation and transcendence truly happens through revelation. The word itself actually stems from the meaning disclosure of information to man by a divine or supernatural agency, as well as unveiling or uncovering of sorts. As we've seen so far, humanity is undergoing an exponential increase in veils being lifted, and we are seeing life being stirred up and changed like never before. One analogy we might use here is as if humanity has been in the dark for so long, isolated by socioeconomic and cultural divides, and yet with modern technology, it would seem as though the lights are collectively turning on. But now, there is so much light, all at once, that it is blinding. And despite our access to so much information today, we are still just as blind as we ever were. That is, while we allow time for our eyes to adjust. Yet the root of revelation doesn't just speak to veils lifted, but our own revelation from divine origin. Belief systems and ideologies are challenged in mass as new information comes out that asks us to reassess our paradigms of identity. As this happens, those who are willing to explore new ideas grow, and those who rail against anything new only burrow deeper into their own existing paradigm. Even in the new world we are creating, there are bound to be different paradigms that people live within. We must remember that some people are filled with hate, negativity, and suffering, all of which are descending from their own pain, which inhibits their higher consciousness and keeps them rooted in a lower vibration. This does not mean that they are bad people, for the only true remedy is compassion. No matter how far disconnected from their soul someone may be, they can always come back to the light. However, the only way for this to take place is if they genuinely want to, for unless someone seeks their own salvation, they will never end up finding it. Thus, it doesn't matter if someone spends their time living in a VR reality for years, abuses their bodies, or even in some future reality, travels throughout the universe. All paths through life can be taken, but only one path leads to the liberation of the soul. This is the path within. May this be a lesson for all of us too, for if we are afraid of the darkness within us and others, and we attempt to quell it by attacking it with anger and hate, then we lessen our own vibration and reduce ourselves to the same state of consciousness as that which we are fighting against. Evil begets evil, and in the words of a wise Jedi Master, fear leads to anger, anger leads to hate, and hate leads to suffering. Hence, the true solution to the salvation of humanity, or the reconnection of our souls as we discussed so long ago, is through genuine and authentic compassion. By elevating our own consciousness to such a degree that our light radiates to those around us, and we become instruments of sacred transformative change by the goodness that we embody. And while this may sound to some like spiritual woo, the discoveries around this today have the power to radically change everything we think we know about both science and religion. These discoveries speak to a deeper, basic, and more intrinsic understanding about the nature of who we are and our place in the cosmos, as well as the abilities that we have and may inherit. Speaking to the nature of consciousness itself, these discoveries are so paradigm-shattering that life on Earth as we know it will never be the same once the knowledge becomes commonplace among the people of the Earth. That is, if it's ever allowed to get there. For a long time, our perception of spirituality has been governed by the religions of the world, and our perception of the universe and the nature of life has been governed by science. Movies like Zeitgeist outline and identify ways in which the religious institutions have monopolized people in a myriad of ways, while others today, such as Dr. Rupert Sheldrake's The Science Delusion, demonstrates how science has been used to shepherd people into a mindset, keeping us locked into a paradigm of physicality and nothing more. Further, these two voices of science and religion have been at odds for a very long time, sharply criticizing one another or otherwise outright refusing to acknowledge each different perspective, or their many merits and wisdoms that they bring forth. Despite this, today new revelations about the nature of consciousness stand to shatter the illusion of separateness, destroy the dogma we've clung to for so long, and give us a foundational blueprint to create a new world for ourselves. Truly, it's how we can create heaven on earth. All that's required is our complete participation. One example of this is found in the work of Dr. Bruce Lipton with The Biology of Belief, which explains with profound scientific logic that our beliefs and self-identity are a product of our environment, and that as we think it, so shall we become. His work describes that if we spend our lives believing that my family had a hereditary disease, so I'll get it too, you are consciously and subconsciously programming your body with signals that will facilitate you creating that outcome. And of course, this belief and others can come from our parents and family or the environments that we expose ourselves to. When we look at all of our childhood programming together, we find today a mashup of countless different media programs and entertainment, news stories, passed down rhetoric and ideas that we received from friends and others around us. Who we are today was shaped by the world, and while many of the lessons that we received growing up were good and valid, many others were simply long-held beliefs that have been passed down for generations, yet may not hold our highest interest at heart. These beliefs shaped our perspective of the world, and in that, how we behave and act, which leads us to create our destinies. As it would seem, many of the belief systems we hold on to disempower ourselves from being able to live our lives to the fullest. Further, many of the largest industries today are built upon previous paradigms, and so their continued growth means the limiting of this new understanding. For example, we return here to the pharmaceutical industry. If you help someone cure their depression, it's very difficult to justify charging them thousands of dollars a year for a prescription. It is far easier and much more lucrative that their depression or illness will be with them for a very long, long time. We must understand that the environment has played a very significant role in the creation of our collective reality, even from the moment that we were conceived and all of the experience that we've had since birth. And while birth defects do exist, Bruce's research says that 95% of people have perfectly fine DNA and can change how their genes are expressing themselves if they will it so. For some, this may be easier than it is for others, but it's very empowering research nonetheless. If we can change the signals our bodies are receiving, the thoughts and feelings we tell ourselves and receive from others, the places we live, the music we listen to, the food that we eat, the entertainment we watch, all of these aspects will play a role in reshaping our lives by influencing us from surface to very deep levels. As Bruce's work suggests, it doesn't matter what ails you. If you can address the root cause and provide yourself with a stimulus of a higher vibration, there is nothing that you cannot heal. To add even more weight to the conversation of science and spirituality finding union, as we go back in time to explore the practices of our ancient world, we find the roots of spirituality steeped in mysticism. To many cultures, such as the ancient Egyptians, Greeks, Indians, Native American shamans, and other Aborigine tribes, we find a great body of wisdom concerned with mystical and altered states of consciousness, as well as the use of psychedelic plant medicine. Today, and thanks to some amazing scientific pioneers, such as Dr. Rick Strassman, and even the darker experiments we've explored already concerning psychedelics, these substances are powerful tools that can be used in a myriad of ways. The stories of the Montauk experiment say that people in the labs had their psychic abilities enhanced to the point where they could materialize objects out of thin air, but at the cost of their emotional and mental stability. This further alludes to the theories put forth by psychedelic scientists, who discuss and theorize that there may be other dimensions or realms of existence that seem to exist all around us, which psychedelics give us access to, not just to visualize, but interact with, which enhance our own psychic abilities. It is herein we find a powerful surge of revelation that pours through concerning science and religion, for it is not entirely uncommon for a number of beings to visit you during your journeys, including meeting ascended masters such as Thoth, Jesus, or Buddha, magical beings such as elves or dragons, or even aliens of a wide variety of kinds. It's almost as if to suggest that while material science has focused on understanding the workings of the third dimension, religions of the world have more focus around interacting with these higher realms and the beings who inhabit them. Psychedelics, then, while not the only method of communication and interaction with higher dimensions, do seem to be a potent tool for bridging our consciousness with higher worlds and connecting the gap between the material and the immaterial. And this is only one of several uses of psychedelics, for just as much as they may expand our sensory awareness outside of us into other planes of existence, so too do they expand our awareness inside of us, bringing to light and visualizing the subconscious and unconscious aspects of ourselves, which may be used in shifting and restructuring our inner frame of being. As the Institute of Noetic Sciences is proving today, along with what was put forth by Dr. Bruce Lipton, our consciousness and intention steers our reality, steers our focus, and therefore our actions. As it relates to sacred ceremonies, treating it as a holy and sacred experience would yield entirely different experiences than treating it as a party drug. And so while deep healing can happen with plant medicine, that doesn't mean that it will happen, and ultimately, it comes down to you. Today, a remarkable number of testimonials have been shared from those who have participated in these plant medicine ceremonies, especially when under the care of a true shaman. These kinds of ceremonies provide a sacred space for purging darkness, revealing profound truth, finding healing and forgiveness, and the merging of the soul. But it's not just ayahuasca, for even psilocybin mushrooms are showing tremendous success rates in clinical trials for helping people cure their depression, anxiety, or addiction to smoking, drinking, and other substance abuses, far above any other conventional methods for treating the same things. This is something that we must learn to take seriously, but we also must approach it with caution. Just as much as there are genuine shamans and amazing pure-hearted healing centers, there are also plant medicine charlatans who will attempt to use these vulnerable states that the psychedelic states facilitates and use them for malicious or self-centered purposes. This can happen when the intention of the space or the shamans are not fully in alignment with the soul, nor in authenticity or integrity. For this reason, we personally at Spirit Science will only recommend healing centers that we have been to and verified their quality, and we highly recommend watching our YouTube movie, Are Miracles Real? The Secret Mysteries of Ayahuasca, if you haven't seen it already. Set, setting, and substance are all important when it comes to plant medicine healing. And often just doing something local, in a city with untrained shamans, or just going with the cheapest option available, can do more damage than good. Someone who might truly benefit from a ceremony could all the same have a psychotic breakdown if they have too much in an improper environment or with shamans who are unfit to deal with the depth of psychic energy that is released in the ceremony. And to that end, this very well may be one of the aspects of psychedelics that we as a species will have to grapple with. For their return to our lives in a meaningful way, just as the ancient mystics practiced so long ago, comes with the revelation of a deeper psychic connection with one another. This notion alone may bring with it a great deal of chaos as we come to recognize that our thoughts and feelings are not isolated within us, but extend beyond us in a field and connect with others in an intimate way. This awareness will ultimately bring us together, but the fear of it will also drive many to violently oppose it and deny its existence. One arcane piece of wisdom that may further add weight to this notion is that change is a universal constant. Yet our society and collective egos are often built upon a long-lasting sense of permanence. We often avoid change if we can, and this leads to holding on to things for longer than we ought to, which of course creates more suffering in the process. For those who embrace these mystical states, who explore the nature of higher realms, whether through plant medicine, meditation, lucid dreaming, or through other spiritual practices, a new paradigm begins to emerge. And in this world, true transcendence becomes possible, and the changes that are coming over the following decades will be much easier than they may be otherwise. This has to be a personal choice for each of us, as many will choose to fight for the old paradigm, and the transition to the new may be even more chaotic and uncomfortable for those who do. And just as the scientific paradigms go through profound changes, revealing an even more connected understanding of reality, so too will the world's religions be forced to transform. If people in mass begin experiencing the ascended master avatars together in these higher worlds, then religious separation must fall away, as the many dogmas of the world too break down, revealing a much more universal truth, true unity consciousness, and the demiurgic state of being can no longer survive within our bodies and minds. We discover that we truly are made in the image of the Creator, meaning that the spiritual essence, call it God, Source, Spirit, or even Sophia if you prefer, is a creative essence, and this same power moves through us too. We are creators in our own right. All that has been created so far in our world is a result of our thoughts, feelings, and labor. And just as we have created a mass disconnection, so too can we create connection, unity, and love. And yet, this is still not the end in the birthing process of the new paradigm. For if we choose to embrace the belief of it, we may just allow ourselves to experience ascension. If we look back into ancient history, there are stories told about something so much greater in store for us, the freeing of earthbound limitations that keep us tethered to this plane of being. The concept of ascension itself mostly came from the stories of Jesus as he rose to heaven after his resurrection, ascending to a higher plane. But we also see it spanning back through Greek, Indian, and even Egyptian mythology, which told stories of beings who transformed into deities through their striving for wisdom. The tales of the Greek Hermes Trismegistus are especially prominent here, as well as what is written in the Emerald Tablets of Thoth. According to what is told of Hermes, he was a man who mastered the three parts of the wisdom that makes up the whole universe, and in doing so transformed himself into a god. These three parts are as follows: alchemy, the union of matter and energies from one state into another; astrology, the understanding of the cosmic cycles and how time and space bend and flow from state to state around us; and theurgy, the understanding of spiritual practice, including magical rituals and the invocation of the divine powers around and through us to produce lasting change in this world and the next. In the Emerald Tablets of Thoth, who is also often equated as the same being as Hermes, it tells a story about how upon ancient Atlantis, long before the fall of consciousness, a man named Chiquetet Aralik Vomelites sought after cosmic wisdom and made this the focus of his life and his devotion. And as a result of his efforts, putting all other earthly pleasures beside him, he found his way into sacred spaces unavailable to the masses deep within the earth, and in doing so became a god, a master of time and space, free to move bodily between dimensions as well as through time. In these writings, Thoth, mirroring the words of Jesus, tells us that we too may follow in these pathways and may also attain to these levels of consciousness if we should so desire. And from these kinds of stories, we must ask ourselves, could it truly be possible to master our bodies, our minds, and our consciousness to such a degree that we could break free from not only the limits of our human world, but even the bonds of time, space, and gravity? What if through our consciousness, we could perform feats and miracles that rivaled the ascended masters of the past? Stories of Jesus say that he could walk on water, heal the sick, raise the dead. And after he himself returned from the dead, he lifted his body into the air and disappeared into heaven. How might we explain this scientifically with our new understanding of consciousness? Perhaps with enough conscious presence within the body, and with a strong enough energetic field or light body, we could begin to learn how to control the forces of nature. In science today, we know them as the strong force, the weak force, the electromagnetic force, and gravity. The strong force binds the atomic nucleus. The weak force controls radioactive decay. The electromagnetic force binds molecules together, and gravity binds bulk matter. Out of these four, gravity is the least understood, having seemingly negligible effects on molecules or atoms due to their mass. Being a curvature in space-time, it isn't like the other forces, as it appears to be one of the fundamental guiding aspects of our reality. The force of gravity is somewhat of an illusion, though, as current theories state that matter tells space-time how to curve, and space-time tells matter how to move. Then again, Nikola Tesla fundamentally disagreed that space was curved, and beheld different theories of gravity which are still contested today, since gravity is not well understood. The level of mastery we would require to overcome these forces, however, would be outstanding. Consider, to move your physical body into another dimension, or even through the dimension of time, would require that you have such an incredible amount of conscious presence flowing through each and every atom of your body, and even understand how these forces apply themselves to your body in order to move your form from one state to another without losing limbs, organs, or even just becoming lost in time forever. On one hand, this may be possible with enough technological know-how, yet on the other hand, true transcendent liberation may only come through utilizing our biological technology that we have been given. With spiritual devotion, it is likely that the first aspect we would learn to manipulate would be gravity, giving us the ability to levitate and move our bodies in three dimensions through space by understanding and warping it around us. Then, greater levels of mastery will enable us control over the electromagnetic force, meaning our molecules. This may give us power to change how our bodies appear, and potentially even support our body's renewal long past what we would normally consider possible. This may be the secret to physical immortality. After that, we could learn to consciously play with our atoms, which would support us in transforming our bodies and potentially other objects at will. Is this what Thoth described when he said he was free to move through time and space? Or could it be what was said about the ancient Lemurians and how they were able to change their bodies at will? As we master the forces of nature, especially understanding the forces at a subatomic level, we may also enable ourselves to become quantumly entangled through time and space. We may learn how to physically time travel or move into other dimensions of reality. We can travel throughout the universe and search for new planets and other species to connect with. As we explored previously, often stories of profound DMT experiences, people describe arriving in elaborate geometric cities and meeting beings of light. While psychedelics can sometimes give us a glimpse of seeing these worlds temporarily, with a high enough level of mastery over the forces of nature, it may be possible to travel there bodily. What's especially curious about this entire theory, however, is that it seems to depend entirely upon our own belief systems as to whether it becomes possible. And yet, this is self-evident by nearly all of our technological evolution today, and the speed at which we may attain these levels also depends entirely on us. Think about it. If nobody ever had any interest in building a car, or collectively we didn't believe that an automobile was even possible, then we would all still be riding horses right now. There was a time in mass when nobody believed it would be possible to ever set foot on the moon, until enough stories, like the writings of Jules Verne, inspired enough imaginations, and suddenly this once impossibility became a collective dream, and then transformed into an actual ambition. But had those books never been written, and the dreams never believed or considered, we certainly wouldn't have rockets going up and down into the atmosphere on a regular basis. Therefore, this process of ascension may take no time at all, or it may take thousands of years for us to attain this level of mastery. It really depends on us and our desire to reach into this kind of higher reality. For many, this future feels out of reach without significant help, as nearly all of us are lost to some degree within the demiurge, doing our best within the circumstances that have befallen us in life, and the amount of healing work and spiritual discipline that is required to be done is tremendous. Further, not all souls are willing to embrace this information, for it is an entirely new paradigm of belief that conflicts with their existing one, and thus it is far easier and far safer to not consider anything new. And that's the ultimate caveat here. Just as we explored before, if you want to believe a belief system that doesn't agree with the majority of the world, such as the earth being flat or even hollow, either way, your belief system will inform your actions, and this dictates the quality of your life. And then we have to ask the question, if someone believed in something that was completely untrue, but this person had a happier life, would we find the argument that this belief, even if untrue, was a good one to hold? Asked in a simpler way, is it better to be right or to be happy or fulfilled? It seems in the end, this is something for each of us to decide. For while so many look to these conspiracy theories with fear of the influence of control imposed upon them, does that not also indicate that their beliefs limit what they are capable of doing based on the control systems that they believe are there? However, if at the highest level of creative powers behind all things in the universe is truly benevolent, as nearly every spirituality of the world has purported since the dawn of man, then that would also indicate that the deep state and all the negative powers that be are also a part of the divine order, even necessary for us for some reason, perhaps in learning the lessons of who we are on our great journey of discovery as humans. These conspiracy theories, while certainly dark and often terrible, could even be a fundamental necessity in order for ascension to take place one day in the future. While for some, the ascension paradigm resonates true and certain, for others, there is doubt and skepticism, fear and loathing. And certainly, it is for each of us to find our own truth and to embrace all that life has to offer with open hearts and minds. What happens if you embrace the ascension path, but at the end of your life, you still cannot fly? Does that make you wrong? Or does that simply mean that you have more work to do on your soul path before you can get there? We may also be reminded of the legendary 4-minute mile, in which for as long as history can tell, humanity believed it was impossible to run a mile in only 4 minutes. That is, until 1954, when Roger Bannister completed the run in 3 minutes and 59 seconds. Then, like explosions going off around the world, the 4-minute mile was broken again and again and again. As the belief system that it was impossible was shattered, suddenly a new paradigm was entered, and now running 4-minute miles are commonplace. What this shows us, it would only take one person publicly demonstrating that they can levitate their body, revealing this gift to the world, that would trigger the ultimate of revelations, tremendous chaos most likely, as belief systems and paradigms shifted all over the world, and we begin to emerge into a new, ascended reality. Then again, as we've seen time and time again, there are countless ways in which ideas like this are covered up, laughed at, insulted, or avoided altogether. As we've seen, the mainstream world likes to focus on specific things at specific times and facilitate micro and mass action through everything from fear to censorship. If there's one thing we've learned from this whole conspiracy theory of everything, is that this information is out there, but it's also not the most important thing to most people. But as long as the mainstream dictates the global conversation, and spirituality is hidden and veiled within entertainment as pure fiction, then perhaps these future transcendent realities will always be just out of our reach, as it's up to each of us to make personal decisions that steer us towards what we want, and realize that on the path up the mountain of transcendence lies an ever-increasing mountain of traps. The demiurge is very tricky, and it won't let go unless you shine your light bright enough to free yourself from the veil of the night. For the nature of the demiurge is to steer us further into the illusions, and it's our journey to work our way out. But hey, all of this, it's just a theory, a conspiracy theory of everything. And you know what? The truth is, this is one of our goals that we hold for ourselves within our very own mystery school, which was established to help facilitate the evolution of consciousness for those who truly want to do the work and go the distance. Each and every day, this growing community is actively discussing and working towards this kind of goal, but understanding that to get there, we must heal our inner wounds, balance our energies, and take leaps and bounds forward into embodying the highest expression of our souls.